afternoon, Jesse, and thanks everybody for joining us. Glad to have you here today. Today we're going to be talking about sort of GDOTs is what we call them, grantor deemed owner trusts, but they also go by the name of intentional grantor trust or irrevocable grantor trust, and probably some other names as well. But one of the things that we've had to work with lately is a couple of larger clients who are creating these types of entities, and in one case created it probably 4 or 5 years ago, and another one that's in the process of creating and funding one. And the issue for both of these clients is that they've got companies that either have grown substantially, and I guess they're kind of plateaued, but I mean they're plateaued at about $15 million a year in profit and cash flow. And they want to sell that company. And then the other one is still in a growth mode, and we'll look at their profits. They're pretty significant too. And they're building for a sale potentially for 5-6 years down the road. And so what we want to do is be thoughtful as we do these kind of trusts and be thinking about and modeling out various options that might happen down the road so that we're prepared for sale, we're prepared for a substantial recognition of income, capital gains at sale time, and so we have an idea of what's going to happen in terms of how is the tax going to get paid. So that'll all become a little bit more clear, I think, as we go along and get through the preliminary material and look at some of the models that we've built for these clients. But it's basically the same sort of a thing that you'd have. I mean, these sound like relatively large cases, and they are, but it's the same thing you'd have at any level where you're thinking about things like how much stock, how much LLC interest, how much LP interest, whatever you're funding with. Should I get into the GDOT, whether it's by gift or by sale, so that we get the kind of optimal results, which are great results from a wealth transfer, from a personal cash flow, and from a sort of an income tax issue down the road, so that we don't end up harming our client, also that they can get more money to their kids and grandkids. So we're going to start out probably in the first 10 minutes or so, just quickly going through a typical transaction background, just to make sure that we all understand what's going on. Kyle, you're running the slide, so this is a perfect good slide to start with. We've got a goal of passing assets to the heirs, so we've got clients who are saying, look, we're ready to transfer some money to our kids or grandkids or whoever it is that they're going to go to. What's the best way of doing it? So let's take a look at the next slide. Most of you on the phone would be familiar with the idea that we'll probably going to use some sort of an entity. So if we're dealing with a private business owner, they may already have an entity that is sufficient to use for these purposes. Oftentimes we'll see clients with LLCs or S-Corps, and oftentimes they're single member and they're one class of stock. I use that term loosely because of the S-Corp limitations. But generally there's a all voting interests. So we may have to sort of rehab that so that the entity has some voting and non-voting so that we can give away or sell the non-voting interests. And if we don't have a good entity that we can use that's in existence, then we would probably look to create one that would also have those same characteristics. So they'd have some sort of voting and some sort of non-voting shareholder interests. So that we can keep the control of the entity with our client and get rid of the equity or the non-voting interests to the kids and the grandkids. In order to do that, you have to make sure that there's more going on than just, tax planning. There are plenty of other reasons why people typically do these, and you can see a list on the slides here. We're not going to go through them. I'm assuming that everyone understands business purpose on the call. But, you know, again, if you can't find any real legitimate business purposes other than that you want to do tax planning, you might want to think twice about it. But in my experience over doing this over, you know, many, many years is that you can pretty much always find good, legitimate business purposes for doing these types of entities and this type of planning. Okay. So we've got an entity, whether it's an LLC or an FLP or an S-Corp or whatever type of entity we're dealing with. And the next thing we're going to do is create a trust, and usually it's going to be an irrevocable trust. Usually it's going to be a defective trust, which means that for any estate tax purposes, that transfers to it are sort of complete for estate tax purposes. In other words, when the owner dies or the transferor dies, the client dies, whatever you want to call them, the assets won't be pulled back into their estate. But for income tax purposes, a different story, and again, not a mystery probably to most people on the call, the trust income gets attributed back to the client. So if the trust has an investment and it earns $100 of income, the $100 of income shows up on the client's tax return, not the trust tax return. And the client is responsible for paying the income taxes on that income, which, you know, again, a lot of clients will raise their eyebrows when you talk about that. So you have to go through the math, and you have to explain to them why it is that it's a real advantage for them to continue to pay taxes on money that's going to their kids. And basically, the bottom line is it magnifies the gift going to kids without creating any subsequent gifts, at least under the current tax law. So that's generally a plus when your game is to try and pass as much as you can to your kids and your grandkids in the most efficient way. So that's going to come back later in the presentation. That's kind of an issue when you're dealing with large assets and potential sale of large assets, because they typically will generate a lot of taxable income, which could cause a real problem for the client. They might not have the money to pay. But in general, that's what's happening. We've got a trust that is going to hold money for our kids or our grandkids. It's going to be out of the taxable estate, and it's going to be income taxable back to our clients. So you can see this kind of thing happening. We can put money and stuff into the entity, and then, Kyle, let's go to the next slide. Okay, so the next thing that would happen is once we have the entity set up, there would be a transfer of non-voting units, oftentimes by a sale. It could very well be by gift. In one of the cases we're going to look at today, it may be that we're only going to gift. We're not going to do any sale. And that's, again, largely because the modeling tells us that we can't actually do too much transferring, at least not to a grantor trust. We may have to take a look at a different type of trust. In this case, so we've got units that we're going to sell and maybe gift as well to the GDOT. Let's go to the next slide, Kyle. Typically, when you sell, you'll get a promissory note back from the trust. That'll be probably the largest part of the consideration. And again, we're not trying to go through all the details of the transaction today, just the general, so everybody sees what's happening. But in this slide, really what we're highlighting is that the client has to get back equivalent value for whatever they transfer. Otherwise, it's a gift. So if you're dealing with a $100 million company, and you transfer $100 million, but you only get a note that's worth $80 million, you've made a taxable gift. So you want to just make sure that those two things match up, you know, unless you're trying to create a taxable gift, which generally you're not. Okay, let's continue on, Kyle. Okay, in addition to the sale, the client could gift membership interests to the GDOT and use exemption. So I think there was some published articles in the last week or two that the new exemption is going to be raised a little bit more for inflation. You may have clients who already have done this sort of transaction. Maybe they want to transfer a few more interests to use up the available exemption. But if you're dealing with sort of a newer client and they haven't used the exemption, which is, you know, sort of typical, then an outright gift of LLC units or S-Corp units, whatever we're dealing with, could be a good part of this plan as well. Okay, let's continue on. All right, now, in terms of cash flow, so we've got basically a client who's given away and sold a lot of interests in a private company to their defective trust. For the sale, there's a promissory note, and so the question is, how does that note get paid? And typically the answer would be is that you would look to the company making the money to make distributions, in effect, dividend distributions out to the owners. So if this was a typical transaction, you'd see most of the entity would be owned by the GDOT. So most of the income distributions would go to the GDOT. Let's go to the next slide, Kyle. All right. Again, if there are if there is a promissory note obligation, it's typically going to call for at a minimum interest payments on the principal, and oftentimes it'll call for amortization as well. And a lot of that is it's just a design decision that you make at the beginning, based on available cash flow and needs of the business for cash and so forth. But typically you want to try and design the cash flow and the promissory note so that it, you know, resembles a real commercial note as much as you can. We've been in situations where cash flow has been tight because the company that we're dealing with is growing and they really need to keep money in the company and they don't want to make a lot of distributions. You know, under those circumstances, your choices are more limited. So you might consider doing a note that has interest that accrues instead of pays for a period of time, and I wouldn't go too long on that, but maybe 3 to 5 years you might think you could reasonably do. So your interest is not building up, so you don't actually have to require the company to make any distributions, but your principal balance is getting larger because those interest payments don't go away, they just get added to principal, so your note gets bigger. So somewhere down the road, you're going to need to pay the piper. But again, business reality sometimes dictates what actually happens in situations like this. Okay, let's go to the next slide, Cal. Okay, now, the whole idea here is that you have transferred an asset that's going to appreciate faster than the note payments. And so, of course, that includes interest, and as everybody knows, interest is still at pretty historic lows. And so if you've got a company that's doing 20%, but your interest rate on your note is at, say, 3.5%, then you're getting a lot of appreciation in value, a lot of equity appreciation over what's owed on the note. All of that appreciation essentially benefits the GDOT beneficiaries, which are your kids and your grandkids. So again, if it's a $100 million company and it's doing, let's say, $20 million a year in profit, and you've got a note at 3.5%, so that means you've got to have interest payments of $3.5 million. The difference, which is about $16 or $16.5 million, is now accruing to your children, or at least to the trust for your children, or grandchildren, or whoever else might be beneficiaries. So it's a very, very effective means of passing wealth on to kids. And in some cases, the earlier you do it, the better. In some cases, it's hard to get younger business owners to think that way. But in terms of, you know, the effectiveness of the strategy, the sooner that you start something like this, the better. Okay, let's go to the next slide, Kyle. Okay. we've already talked about some of the things here that I really want to talk about, which is the income tax side of things. We haven't really talked yet about cash flow, so let's go back two slides for just a second, Kyle. Yeah. So in a case where you've got a company, a real operating company, which in today's discussion, that's really what we're talking about, you've got clients that own this and, you know, they're used to living on the profits, or at least receiving the profits. Probably don't need to live on them, but they do need, they need to receive some of them to live on. So how, if you transfer all the company away, how do they get their money? And again, usually it's coming through the form of promissory note payments. So in the first case that we're going to, in the second case we're going to look at, we've got a guy who's built a very successful business, and at our recommendation transferred 60% of the company stock over to a trust for his kids and kept 40%. So what's been happening is, up until recently, he's been getting 40% distributions from the company. So let's just say his profit's $10 million, just to keep the math easy. So he's been getting $4 million, and the trust has been getting $6 million. Now, the issue comes up here, or the thing to think about here, is that he's getting taxed on $10 million, even though he's only getting four. So there's a mismatch there, and he gets a nice salary, which is effectively what he lives on. And then the $4 million that he gets in distributions is generally enough to pay the income taxes on the $10 million of income. So he's not really getting the benefit of the profit distributions at this point, because he's using them all to pay taxes, or at least most of them. So that's great for the kids, because when they get $6 million in their trust, they really get $6 million. They don't get $6 million and then have to pay $2.5 million in income tax. So it's very advantageous from a wealth transfer point of view. So that's not always the way it is. I mean, in the past, this guy had some promissory notes outstanding. The kids' trust was paying some money to them. And then last year, they ended up getting paying off those notes. And so that kind of terminated the cash flow there. And then this year, there's going to be a sale of the company with any luck. And it's probably going to sell for somewhere around $80 to $100 million, perhaps a little bit more. Sort of in the sale process now, so it's difficult to say. But what we're working on is, you know, what does that look like for this particular client if it sells for $100 million, or if it sells for $80 million, or if it sells for, you know, $60 or $120. And so you'll see in a little bit, we built a model that allows the client to take a look at that, see what the impacts are, and then to make certain decisions. I think since we've talked about this guy so much, I'm going to switch the order a little bit and look at his model first, Kyle, if that's okay with you. And then we'll flip over to the other one. So just sort of in your own mind, just think about, if it sells for $100 million, what I said before about distributions and income taxes and so forth. Now, in this particular case, it'll be a capital gains transaction, so it won't be quite so bad. But he's looking probably at about a 25% tax rate. For sake of argument, let's assume he doesn't have any basis. He does, but it's about $5 million. It's not significant. So if he sells for $100, the tax on that is going to be $25 million. If you think about the fact that he owns 40% of the stock, if it sells for $100 million, he'll get a gross amount of $40 million. He's got to pay $25 million in taxes on the whole amount because of the grantor trust. And that leaves him with $15 million. So you have to, have to ask, is 15 million, sort of the right amount, the amount that he's wanting to receive? And the answer would be, if you talk to him, it would be, no, I want more. I built this whole company, I deserve more. So we have looked at the original trust document. And Kyle, I'm not seeing, maybe it's just me, I'm not seeing any Excel spreadsheet.
How about now?
Sort of seen. Yeah,
should
I'm
be up.
Seeing the introduction slide, but maybe it'll come up in a minute. Anyways, so the point is that we've looked at the trust document, and the trust document was drafted in some ways with this sort of a thing in mind, even though there was no real idea at the time that the company was going to sell. At some point, you gotta think that every company will sell, or go out of business, or get passed on to the next generation. But the sale is obviously the area where you get some difficulty. So the trust was drafted with a few different provisions in it that basically can help us get out of this problem. So the first one is that there's a tax reimbursement provision in the trust. This particular client lives in the state where the appropriate statutes are in place to meet the revenue ruling that the service issued, I want to say in 2004. And basically in that revenue ruling, they said that it was permissible for the trustee of an irrevocable trust like this, a grantor trust, to reimburse the grantor for taxes paid by the grantor on behalf of the trust and trust income. So basically, it's kind of perfect for our situation. Our guy has, a $25 million income tax bill. 60% of that is because of the trust income. And if he got reimbursed, that would put him in a lot closer situation to where he'd want to be in terms of how much he actually takes away from the sale. Now, in order for that to work, the trustee can't be obligated to pay those taxes. It has to be totally discretionary. And if you read the ruling, what you'll see is that the service sort of reserves a little back door, which is that if you do this, and there was an understanding at the time that you created this, that the trustee would sort of play along, then the service could make an argument that you've got essentially a reversionary income interest in the trust, and they would try and include the proceeds in your estate. Nobody's dying in our case, and they would expect to live a good long time. We have no idea what the tax laws might look like 20, 30, 40 years down the road when this guy dies, but still it's an issue. So you've got one potential out is a tax reimbursement clause, and we have one in our trust, so that's a good thing. Another potential out in this case is that the grantor's wife is a beneficiary of this trust, and she's a beneficiary both as a health education, sort of maintenance, ascertainable standard beneficiary. She's also a discretionary beneficiary, and there's an independent trustee who is charged with making distributions to the wife under either of those sections of the trust. So another potential sort of out, if you will, would be to distribute some stock maybe back to the spouse before the sale, or wait until after the sale and then distribute some cash proceeds back to the spouse to pay taxes, or frankly for any other reason. Again, the same sort of thing that we talked about with the tax reimbursement clause could be an issue, which is to say that if you go back to the well and, you know, sort of the wife uses this money as a checkbook and all the money gets back into the husband's hands, I suppose theoretically there's an argument that, again, there's a retained interest in the trust, and there would be an argument to include the proceeds back into the grantor's estate. So, again, it's a potential out. I think that the argument that it's sort of like a pocketbook is definitely one that could be made, so I think you want to be careful on how you use it, but I do think you could use it. The third opportunity we have in this case is to turn this trust into a non-grantor trust prior to sale. And that's another option that we're looking at. There are a couple of provisions that are sort of what I would consider to be standard provisions creating a grantor trust. And the independent trustee has the ability to, if you will, turn those off. So there's a substitution paragraph in there, and there's the ability to add beneficiaries. And the independent trustee has the ability to essentially terminate both of those powers. So the only thing left would be the fact that the grantor's wife is a beneficiary. Now, the fact that she's a beneficiary in and of itself is not always sufficient to make a grantor trust. But in this case, it is. The only way that she could be a beneficiary and have this not be a grantor trust would be if there was an adverse party like another beneficiary who had to consent to any distributions to the wife. So if we're going to terminate grantor trust status, the other thing that we would have to do is name one of the other beneficiaries as sort of to be in this position of basically agreeing to distributions. And you can see how that works, because typically an adverse party isn't going to agree to anything that's going to hurt their own pocketbook. Now, in this particular case, you know, this is a family that gets along. I don't know that that's a problem. But what could be a problem is that families that get along today don't always get along tomorrow. And so the concern that I think we have in this case is putting our clients in a position where we have an adverse party named over distributions to the wife, and then there's some sort of a falling out, and then it turns out that the wife actually needs distributions. Now she has to look to the kid that she's in some sort of a dispute with and kind of beg her for money. Well, I don't think most of our clients want to be in that position. So that's a tough one. It is one way of doing it in this case, but seems like sort of the least attractive one for that reason. But that is certainly a way you could do this. And then we sort of have a final approach, which is a hybrid, which is basically the trust allows the independent trustee to create a new trust, or at least to fund a new trust, so as long as the beneficiaries are not really dissimilar from the existing trust, which would be the case. And the new trust could be a non-grantor trust, which would basically mean that the trust pays its own income tax. So either by turning the existing grantor trust into a non-grantor trust, or by creating and funding another trust that's a non-grantor trust, either way, we would essentially be isolating income taxes at the trust level. So our client would be basically getting his proceeds, paying his taxes, keeping the rest. The trust would now be paying its own taxes. So all those things are good in the sense that it gets more money out of the sale proceeds to the client. And that's really where we're headed. We're also potentially looking at, you know, combinations of all these things. But just the idea here is, when you're drafting these trusts, if you're going to be the drafting attorney, or if you're involved in advising the clients about some of these options, you want to make sure that the trust basically contemplates All of these things, you know, and if for some reason or other they're not used, we're not drafted in, that's fine. I mean, but as long as everybody's thinking about it going in, so they understand that there are some, what I'm going to call, escape hatches, which could potentially, you know, under some circumstances, could really hurt a client if they're not there, because there's no way to get out of this tax burden. Okay, I'm going to try and stop for just a second. I'm going to see if there's any questions. Jesse, I'm also going to try and see if I can figure out why I'm not seeing the spreadsheet.
Okay. I think it could be your computer, Scott, because we're not having any trouble on our end, and it seems all the attendees are seeing the screen okay. If anyone was to have a question, you can raise your hand and we'll unmute you, or you can ask your question in the chat box on the GoToWebinar toolbar.
Yeah, I'm sure it is my computer. So let's, Kyle, you've got the spreadsheet open, and you know this case. Why don't you walk us through sort of the variables that we have and how that impacts the outcomes and some of the things that we discussed when we had all these various conferences with the client on what's, you know, and the advisory team on, you know, what sort of options are available.
Sure. So we'll pay attention first to the top graph that you're seeing on the screen, which is the green area graph. And this is really probably the most important to the client. We already know that based on the success of the business and of the trust planning thus far that the daughters are already going to get a lot. So he's a little bit less concerned about how he's going to be able to get them enough money because we've made it pretty clear to him, and he's now starting to agree that the daughters and then now his new grandchild will have plenty of money through the trust. So the focus really was already pretty much there on how he and his wife were going to be able to remain in a comfortable lifestyle, and they've really never been huge spenders, but over the last couple of years they started to spend a little bit more, and actually they probably had a hard time spending even $300,000 or $400,000 a year up until a couple of years ago, and now they're building purchasing a new house, putting a huge addition on one of the houses they already have, and he's starting to think about other ways that he might want to spend his money in the future, while also taking into consideration how the effect of his business sales value would affect the money that he and his wife have to live on. So you can see here up in the top right, these are all the numbers that we have to work with in terms of their current personal liquidity and assumed business sale values. So we can toggle in here while we're sitting there in front of the client and kind of in a live presentation change the assumed business value to show how it's going to affect their personal liquid assets over time. So if we change it down to $80 million, we can show them that they're going to run out of money sooner based on other spending and investment habits and trends. Okay, so that brings us down to the next option, which is what would investment returns, how would the investment returns affect their personal liquidity? And something to remember that's important here is investment returns aren't only going to affect their personal assets, it's also going to affect the income tax on them from the assets held in their existing trust, because their existing trust, we're still assuming right now that it's a grantor trust, so the income or any dividends from stocks, any interest from cash or other assets that are owned inside this trust post-sale are going to affect the income tax on our clients personally, which is also going to draw down on their personal liquid assets. So it's really just kind of another item that that needs to be considered as we move forward. And obviously, as the trusts in the trust assets grow, so will taxable income liability from those assets to the clients, at least as long as we keep it as a grant or a trust. The next section down has to giving them is taking a look at their spending habits. So this one right here is a monthly spending number. And then you can see below we've added in a couple of other items like capital expenditures. This is to add some flexibility into their spending habits. So they may spend a little bit more or a little bit less, but average out to approximately the same monthly amount. But then they say, well, what if we want to do something like we're doing this year, which is buy a new house? How is that going to affect our personal assets? So we've got some items in here that every 5 years they have some kind of capital expenditures where it's over and above their typical monthly spending. And then the other item when it comes to kind of some of their capital expenditures, we come down in here to annual trust distributions. Now, when we were first talking with them, they said, well, you know, what if we want to buy our daughters a house, or what if we want to, right now we're making annual gifts to our daughters, and we want to fund the grandchild's education in the future. They were concerned about what kind of effect that would have on their personal liquidity. So then you can start having the conversation about, well, do you really want to make those home purchases for the daughters, or those annual gifts to the daughters, or funding the grandchildren's education? Do you really want to make those from personal assets? Or since you're going to have all this money in this trust for their benefit anyways, do you want to utilize trust assets to make those gifts or home purchases for the daughters and grandchild? And that'll help ease some of the effect of personal spending on the clients. So it's just another conversation to have and consider and analyze when you're talking about how much they want to have available, how long you think they're going to live, and how much they want to spend while they're still living. I don't know, Scott, did you want to get into at all the third trust or the second trust option at all?
Well, yeah, I do. I'm back on senior screen. So if you look down, the next section, reimburse for CG taxes. So what we did here was we built in an option to reimburse for the sale taxes, sort of post-sale, that could reimburse 100% or any percent up to 100%. And then we also modeled in transferring a percentage of the business to a new trust that would be a non-grantor trust. So, for example, we're showing 50% being transferred to the new trust pre-sale, so that income tax would basically be tagged to the new trust. If we did 100% in that, what you'll see, or you should see, is that green now lasts a lot longer. Okay. Now, why is that? That's because all the future tax liability of the grantor trust is no longer on the grantor. Now it's essentially embedded in the new trust for the kids. So that means the client's personal assets are going to last a lot longer. Now, one of the discussion pieces we're having is, you know, exactly on this point. Do we want to do this? Or let's go back to 50%, Kyle. All right, so now you can see clients are running out of money sooner. What does that really mean? What happens if they start to run out of money? Or if we get out 10 years and they're still on the decline? Well, the existing irrevocable trust that you see with the blue shaded area, okay, that's money that's essentially in trust for three beneficiaries, the wife and the two kids. And the wife is the primary beneficiary. So you can see that asset base is really building nicely in that trust. And of course it is, because it's growing without income taxes. So one of the things that we would probably look to do is to make a fairly large distribution to the wife sometime in the future, whether it's 5 years or 10 years out or 15 or 20, whatever. But essentially, it would be an amount that would sort of restock the client's personal assets. And at that point, we also might elect to transfer some more assets over to the new non-grantor trust to help, again, with management of ongoing income tax drain on the clients. All right. So I'm going to think that we should jump to the other situation, Kyle. Just we've got about 15 minutes. So in any event, the point is that we're able to show through this model, and the model has changed as the client's seen it, and he's asked questions, and we've responded to that and added things to the spreadsheet. So the client is now able to say, okay, I get what's happening. I see how we can manage this. I understand what the risk is and what my options are. So now I can make an intelligent decision about this. And really that's all we're trying to do, is to try and help the client figure out how to make a decision that's right for them at a particular moment in time. And at the beginning, all that goes back to the very beginning design stage when you're thinking about how do we design this trust so that it provides enough flexibility for the client so that they can have these kind of discussions later on, you know, when they come up, as opposed, you know, I mean, it's really very academic at the beginning stages for a lot of clients. You know, they're probably not selling, they're not thinking about selling. So you just want to make sure that you build in this flexibility so that down the road they can have it and they have options. Okay, we're going to switch over to another set of facts now. This is an existing client. I think we've been working with them for about 2 or 3 years. And they've got a successful company that's growing. It's a pretty large company. It's got professional management. Although the client is still really, really involved in the business, loves the excitement, loves the success, and is very successful. In this particular case, we are looking at the question of, okay, how much of the company stock that he owns should be transferred to the grantor trust. Okay. And he's saying, look, I want to help my kids, but he's kind of Warren Buffett-y about it. You know, I don't want to give them the life of Riley for the rest of their life. I just want to help them out. He's not sure what he's going to do with the rest of the stuff, but he doesn't want to make them incredibly rich, although it's kind of unavoidable. He wants to make sure that he and his wife can enjoy, you know, to do whatever they want to do. They sort of view this, rightly so, as money they earned and built. And if they want to have 10 houses and a couple of jets, then that's what they want. I don't think they do, but you get the idea. They want that kind of flexibility. So he said, how do I know how much stock I should transfer to the trust? And what we said is, well, we'll build a model that we think will address the concerns that we've seen with other clients, and let's see how you react to that, and then, you know, depending on what questions or thoughts you have, we can modify the model, you know, to meet your particular needs. So that's what we're going to be seeing here. You have a whole bunch of stuff on the left that are numbers, and then you have five charts, I think, here, and these are things that these are sort of things that we've seen with other clients over the years, and every client's different. So we just, you know, are saying, what's the universe look like? I'm not saying one of these is more important than another to a particular client, but how do we sort of give them a dashboard so that they can see the impact of one decision versus another? So the first thing that we're looking at is company stock owned by the client, the way they are now, and after they would transfer a certain amount to the trust. Now, that'll, of course, change depending on how much they transfer to trust. And again, what clients are looking at here is sort of a balance between how rich am I versus how rich are my kids, okay? That's kind of the issue there, and everybody's going to be different. I mean, to them the question is really is, how much do you personally feel like you're comfortable with? Okay, now, I mean, to some degree, you'd be looking at me and saying, well, they've got $100 million under this example. What's to be uncomfortable about? You know, again, everything is always, you know, it's not in isolation. It's compared to what? And who knows what they're going to want to do in the future. They're relatively young. So it's not up to me to decide what is the right number for them. Our goal is to just try and help them put it in perspective. The next question in the top right is how much of the errors to get over time, sort of in the as-is plan versus the trust plan. Now, this is much more complicated than it would appear, but basically what this is doing is tracking growth of the company over time and then hitting it with estate tax. And so that's what the kids would get in red is after estate tax. That's kind of the way they are now. The parents just held all the stock themselves. The green is how much extra they get if they transfer whatever amount we're illustrating here. I think it's 35% over to the GDOT. So obviously they get more. Why is that? That goes way back to our early slides today, which is that if the company is growing really fast and you can get that growth out of the taxable estate, then that growth essentially is a win for the kids, and that's what's being illustrated here. So in a sense, it's kind of the inverse of the next chart I want to look at, which is estate taxes over time. So if you can scroll down just a little bit, Kyle. Sort of in the middle, estate tax over time. This is just looking at the estate tax on the company year by year, assuming that the clients were to die in any given year. And the as-is, of course, relatively high. The green, you know, marginally lower. So it's not zero. It's still very substantial. And why is that? That's because under this example, they're keeping, I think, 65% of the stock for themselves. And that continues to ride up. Now, you might say, well, wouldn't it be better for them to give all the stock to the company? And the answer would be, maybe. That's what we're trying to figure out here. So are they comfortable paying estate tax? Are they comfortable with how much they get to keep for themselves? Are they comfortable with the income that they get off all of this? Are they comfortable with how much they're leaving their kids? That's what this dashboard is all about, is trying to help the client actually get their arms around the impact of their choices. Right now, the company pays a dividend that's sufficient to pay the income tax. All the rest of the money goes back into the growth of the company. The chart that's to the right of the one that we're just looking at, so the top right, says after-tax distribution if 50% of taxable dividend is paid out. Okay, so what we're looking at now is again, just kind of a flat, is a flat distribution to zero because it's not half. This is not happening. We're only paying out for income taxes. So this is now saying, okay, after we pay out for income tax, whatever the remaining profit is, we pay out 50%. And the client wanted to be able to see what happens at different points in time. In this particular case, I think we're starting out 10 years roughly when the dividend would start to pay out. And the question there is how much goes to the defective trust, how much goes to the clients, if they do a transfer of stock, and then how much would they get if they just kept all the stock themselves. So, again, no right or wrong here, just you know, information. And then at the bottom left, this was, okay, so there's another decision being made here. This is a decision about how much insurance they think they want to buy for estate taxes. And I guess I skipped that in the chart just above. That's okay. The idea is they're trying to figure out what they should do in terms of liquidity to cover them in the event that they die at some point while the company is still the company and isn't turned into a big pile of cash. And their budget is basically 12.5% of the profit left after the income tax distribution. So if it's $100 of profit and they're paying out 40 cents for taxes, that would leave them 60 cents, and they'd be willing to pay 12.5% of that for premium. So all we're trying to do here is, let's go back up, scroll back up just a little bit, because again, I think they felt this was extremely helpful. And we're keeping this static at the moment, okay, but in the meetings, we're moving things around based on client conversations. So right now, you could see that even if they do the GDOT, there's going to be a hefty estate tax, and if they pick $30 million as their amount of insurance that they want, there's a real shortfall in the not-too-distant future. There's also, though, sort of a tolerance for premium payments that's, like I said, it's 12.5% of this, you know, this budgeted amount that we're showing below. So again, no right or wrong on how much insurance. It's, but we are showing them what the impact of that decision is to limit premium to a certain amount. So all right, so that's you know, sort of the dashboard features. Over on the left-hand side, we've got a bunch of variables that you can see here. We start out with increasing taxable income after 2016. The CFO of this company has given us a pretty clear picture of what they expect is going to happen over the next 3 years. He's a pretty conservative guy. The rest of the management team that gets paid on performance thinks they're going to do a lot better. But this is, you know, this is a comfortable prediction. After that, the CFO sort of loses the ability to forecast. He doesn't think it's going to get worse or anything, but you can't tell if there's going to be a sort of a rapidly increasing growth or if it's going to get a little bit more stagnant or what might happen. So we built a variable in for increasing taxable income after 2016. And again, I don't really care what they pick. The point is that, you know, the client has the option to see if we change this from 10 to 20, what happens, et cetera. Assuming that we're going to do some sale and some gift of the company, we wanted to build in the GDOT loan section, which would be how they would pay for the GDOT stock, so you could see interest there. We also have a company value multiple. 15 times is essentially what their current multiple is if you look at income versus appraised value. They have multiple owners of this company. Our client is the largest owner, but there are, as I mentioned, the management team is invested in ownership. There's also a public charity that has a small piece of this. So they have to get appraisals every year, and so that's currently what the company multiple is relative to EBITDA. We've got a when does the company start paying dividends and how much do they pay? What's an increase in company value after a certain period of time? Is it going to continue to rocket through after 2025? Who knows? They think they'll probably sell it. If they sell it, are they going to be able to reinvest the cash in something that's going to be generating the kind of returns the company did? Again, who knows what the markets are going to look like at the time. So we would tend to keep a fairly conservative number, but it could be anything. You know, that number could be, again, whatever you want. And then we get into the interplay of how much are we going to sell to the GDOT and how much are we going to gift. Now, Kyle, could you just do me a favor and change the 0 to 10% and the 35 to 25? Yeah. Okay. So what I think we learned last week or the week before is it looks like there's some loan covenants that are going to prevent him in any event from transferring more than 35% of the company away from him. So that's why. And 25% is essentially going to use up most of their exemption with some margin for error. So that's why that number is at 25. So basically, we probably can do a 10% sale, 25% gift. And then if we go back up to the charts, we can sort of see what impact that's having. I guess you can't see too much, relatively speaking. But in any event, because I think we initially were going to try and do a lot more of the stock, and looks like at least for the time being we're going to be limited. In any event, I think you get the idea. Jesse, I see we're about at the end here, so I'm going to just stop and see if there are any questions that anybody might have.
Great, thank you. It looks like we don't have any questions at the moment. Again, you can raise your hand or type your question into the chat box. And then if you think of any questions afterwards, you can feel free to email Scott or Kyle with those.
Good. Okay, so well, I'd like to thank everybody for joining us. I mean, I think the key here is make sure you've got flexibility built in the beginning. And, you know, then as the questions come up, then the idea is to just build models that can effectively demonstrate the range of answers to a client's questions, you know, if they're like this, so that you can just help them make good decisions. And, of course, if you're not into model making, InKnowVision definitely is. So if you have a need for this sort of thing or want to explore some more, feel free to give us a call. We take calls all the time. Love to talk to people about how we could help them, whether it's you know, something that ultimately results in engagement or not. So feel free to reach out. Thanks again, and hope everybody has a great day.